Great to see you all. Thank you so much for the kind introduction. And we have had the opportunity from the city side to partner with the SFU Carbon Talks program over the last couple of years on multiple occasions. You mentioned you're looking for some of the levers for really changing the trend on carbon, and I think cities are one of those. Cities collectively, globally, emit over 70 to 80% of the world's greenhouse gas emissions. So we play a critical role in addressing the challenges that we're facing. And as you can see from the image above, cities are on the cutting edge, really trying to change how we do what we do. There is a transformation underway in cities across the world, rethinking what we do, how we pave our streets, how we run our buildings. So it's very exciting. It's a very, very exciting time to be a part of it. And it's very exciting to be here in Vancouver. And I want to tell you today about our Greenest City Action Plan. Before I do that, I want to tell you one short story from the city of Chicago. So I think this is, as I said, a transformation that's happening in cities across the world. And we have competition. If we really want to be the greenest here in Vancouver, we have competition with other cities that are doing a lot of work on this area and are prioritizing it. This is a project that I worked on in Chicago. It's one of my portfolios were the brownfield issues in Chicago. This is an area actually where they made Pullman cars. This is a 40-acre site. And as part of our portfolio managing brownfield issues in Chicago, I had to deal with this site. And they said, okay, we got to start looking at all the different sites that we have. This one we had the wisdom at some point to take control of before we really realized how bad it was, I guess. It was equivalent of a Superfund site. It was 40 acres, and it was in the middle of a relatively low-income community on the south side of Chicago. And we were really struggling with how do you fix something like this up? It was worth about $2 million, the site, if it were clean. And it was $20 to $30 million to clean it up. So it was kind of an upside-down property. And we were really struggling with how do you turn that kind of thing around. So we worked on it for a few years. And I think that, to me, this epitomizes the opportunity that the greening of our cities represents, which is we can take multiple sets of issues that we have, challenges around economic development, around environmental justice, around the quality of life in our neighborhoods. And this is what we did with that site. We worked with our utility. They were required to provide a certain amount of electricity from green energy sources. And we created the world's largest solar installation in any city on the brownfield site. We didn't clean up the whole site. We capped it. We put gravel over it. And we put 36,000 solar panels. And they track the sun. And now this is acting as a bit of a magnet for economic development in that community. And we worked with disadvantaged populations to train them in some of the skills that they needed. So we created a green job opportunity as well. And all the posts and everything else were made by manufacturing facilities in the neighborhood. So to me, this epitomizes the approach that we're trying to take here in Vancouver. Solve three or four problems with each of the green solutions that we're pursuing. And that is kind of the underlying theme that we've undertaken in pursuing the Greenest City Action Plan. There are a lot of opportunities. The question is, how do we solve three or four problems with each of the solutions that we're pursuing in greening our city? So where are we as a city? Vancouver has the lowest greenhouse gas emissions per capita of any city in North America. So we're really proud of where we're at. We're doing really well. We've set the goal, like 1,200 other cities in North America, to try to achieve carbon reduction levels equivalent to that of Kyoto. So we have very ambitious goals, and we are trying to really lead the world to demonstrate that you can grow your economy, grow your population, while achieving environmental goals. And we've managed, since 1990, we're on track, almost on track, to actually meet or exceed the carbon level reductions, 6% below 1990 levels by the end of the year. I think we're going to be at 5 or 6%, so we're close. We need all of us to plug in and help make the difference there. But we've done that in the context of growing our population 27% and increasing jobs 18%. So Vancouver, in some ways, is demonstrating to the world that cities can have an impact and that we can really pursue multiple agendas concurrently. So we've really got a strong foundation that we're building off of. And the question, as mayor and council came in, was how do we go to the next level? What can we do to further pursue this agenda? They brought together a team of leading experts in the field and said, help us to figure out what it's going to take to really be the greenest city in the world. And some of you were involved in that. They came forward with the Greenest City Action Team report, which went to council. Staff then took that, worked with many of you over a year, consultations, got 36,000 people engaged online and in person, and came out with the Greenest City Action Plan. You've got a summary of it in the brochures that have been provided. There's a longer version of it, which you can download online if you want some of the greater detail on how we're going to be achieving some of these goals. So each there's 10 areas in the plan, and I'm going to run through them for you briefly and outline for you what we're trying to do and a little bit of where we're at in doing that. The first thing we, as we started to look at really implementing this, was to ask ourselves, where do we as a city have leverage? Because some of these areas, clean air, for instance, we don't have that much control of it. It's largely provincial or it's regional. It's decisions that we all collectively make, deciding how we're going to get around or whether we're going to have a wood-burning fire that night or all sorts of different factors in the city that we don't necessarily control. So we looked at where do we have jurisdiction, and the first thing we said is we have to lead by example in our own operations. We've got to be doing this as a city. So we last year rolled out internally our environmental framework for municipal operations, and we took those 10 areas and we kind of really developed the focus areas for where can we really drive the agenda with zero carbon, zero waste, and healthy ecosystems. And then we put that in the context of the broader Greenest City Action Plan. So you see zero carbon, zero waste, and then you see the 10 areas in our action plan. And now we're developing the Green Operations Plan, which really allows us to operationalize that, to get every part of our city working on that. So as I run through for you an overview of the actual plan itself and what we're aiming to do, I want to highlight for you some of the areas where we are working to do this internally. So there's 10 areas in the plan, as I've mentioned. The first is the green economy, and I highlighted the example in Chicago, what we're doing there to create low-barrier green jobs and to support the green economy. We've got some very aggressive targets in this area for Vancouver. We are doing really well globally if you compare a number of green jobs to traditional jobs. So we've got some aggressive goals, which you can see there. There's a few key strategies that we're looking to pursue. Firstly, we want to unlock the purchasing power of the city. We spend a lot of money every year, whether it's buying gasoline or buying vehicles or buying food. We can use that to partner with our local economy, to partner with the companies here. We want to create an enterprise zone, a green enterprise zone, where we can consolidate some of that activity. And we really want to engage, not just thinking about attracting new companies, but engaging existing companies that are here to green their operations. If you make a window, you can make a green window, and you've got additional market share. If you're a delivery company like Rob's company, that Novex Couriers, they bought the first electric trucks in Canada, and it's part of their distribution fleet. Hi, Rob. Thanks for being here. Great examples of companies that have a traditional business line that they're offering, but they can green it, and that can provide an opportunity for them to differentiate their product and hopefully gain market share. We, as a part of that, we really wanted to ensure we're getting low-barrier jobs established, so we launched with Embers a weatherization social enterprise where people can hire this company, and they work with the recent immigrants, train them, and they come and do the weatherization. So this is a company that we launched last year. We helped the fund with Fortis and Hydro to help get some of these jobs, low-barrier jobs, actually out in the community, and it's going really well. If any of you want to do a home renovation or a retrofit to weatherization, that would be a great opportunity to contact them. Climate leadership, I talked about this already. We want to eliminate Vancouver's dependence on fossil fuels, and we want to reduce our greenhouse gas emissions 33% below 2007 levels by 2020. The key areas where we hope to do that is we're really going to be relying heavily on the energy used in and by our buildings. That's about 55% of the greenhouse gas emissions that you'll see. It's outlined in that brochure that we distributed. So we really want to pursue district energy solutions. We now have a zoning requirement that when a new project's moving forward, you got to review the value of doing district energy. That's not always the right solution. There are new, really interesting technologies. You can take the waste heat from part of the building, use that to heat other parts of it if you've got a grocery store or other opportunities. There's air-to-air heat exchangers. There's all sorts of ways to green those buildings. But we think carbon-neutral buildings by 2020, it's a matter of course for larger buildings, is something that we can achieve. And that's part of our carbon goal and part of our green building goal. The district energy system that we have already down in False Creek is delivering about 65% greenhouse gas reductions for the people that are supplied by this district energy system. So we are showing that you can live in the city, have a 65% lower greenhouse gas emission. And in this project, we actually take the waste heat out of the sewage and use it to heat this neighborhood. So now we're thinking strategically, well, how do we expand that? Where are redevelopment opportunities in the city? Where is there demand in the city for new development? And we're looking at an overall strategy to approach district energy. So green buildings ties in directly with that. As I've said, we want to have carbon neutral buildings by 2020, and we want to reduce our energy use in existing buildings. So a two-pronged approach The new buildings is easier. They come in for building permits. There's ways that we can work with them on zoning. The challenge for us is the existing building stock. Buildings like this with the lights and the heat and all the energy that we're using for the AV. And so trying to figure out how do we engage existing building owners in doing those retrofits. So we think the bylaw, if you come in for a building permit to upgrade your building, we require that you do seismic upgrades. We can really start to integrate more on the green building front there. We're looking at changing our fee structure. You get a cheaper building permit if you're integrating green building features as an example. So some of the things that we're looking at, what called fee baits. So there's a lot of opportunities with the regulatory powers that we have, but we're also looking at incentives as well. This is a program we launched a number of months ago, just a couple months ago. It's a home energy loan program, and this you actually pay back your loan. This is in partnership with Vancity. You pay back your loan on your property tax bill, and it's tied in through that. So this is the first program of its kind in Canada, and we're excited about hopefully getting more uptake on it as people realize that tool is out there. So renovating private homes is a critical part of our game plan here, because natural gas is a lot of the greenhouse gas emissions in the city. So four, transportation. How many of you took transit here today? All right. Sorry to do this. How many of you drove your car here today? That was fast. It was up and down very quick, Rob. A few of us. Okay, well, look, that's the thing. We have a diverse city. We're all coming from different places. We need a transportation plan that recognizes that and enables people to get around in the ways that work for them. So if we're going to have vehicles, people are going to continue to drive. Let's get electric vehicles into our fleet. If you want to be on a bike, we want you to be safe. We want you to be in a separated bike lane. We need to find ways to get everybody feeling comfortable about the way that they're getting around, even if we have to get Rob out of his car eventually. So green transportation, how have we been doing? I think Vancouver leads the way for the nation, if not North America, on this. We've increased biking by 180% since 1994. We've increased walking by 44%. We've increased transit ridership by 50% over the last number of years. Meanwhile, we've decreased gasoline sales, and we've decreased the number of trips coming into downtown. So we know when we think about land use, and we think about transportation, and we think about them together, when we plan that way, we can have an impact. The question for us now is, how do we get to the next level? How do we really drive to the next level of reductions? And we think the Broadway corridor is critical from a transportation perspective. Without that, we don't achieve our goals here to really drive the mode shift up to 50% as we outlined. We also think we need to get more people on bikes. We've really seen an impact, but the mode share there is still really low. We need to find more opportunities for people that don't feel comfortable being out in traffic. When we opened the Dunsmuir bike lane last year, we saw a 400% increase in people riding on that street for the morning commute within the first month. So we know people want to be in that kind of infrastructure. We need to do it in a way that's in partnership with the business community and the people that are along that corridor, and want to thank Charles and the downtown BIA for their partnership in doing that. But there's other alternatives. Some of you said you drove here. We partnered with Car2Go. It was the first deployment in Canada of this technology. You jump in the car, you pay by the minute kind of thing, drop the car off where you want it. It's something I was actually working on in Chicago, and then I moved here and worked with them, and they said, actually, yeah, Vancouver looks like a good city. So happy to have that here, and they've had over 100,000 rides in the 7 months that they've been operating in Vancouver. And they've got over 10,000 members, so clearly people are looking for an alternative to owning and operating your own car. Zero waste, something very simple, but actually hard to do. Many of these areas, there are great opportunities for the city to lead. This is one where we've got a long way to go in our own operations as well. You walk into a library now or fire station, you might not find a recycling container. Simple thing. So we're going to zero waste, but we've still got a long way to go in a whole bunch of these areas. But our goal is a 50% reduction from 2008 levels going to landfill. Compostables is the key for us. 30 to 35% of the material in the garbage can is organics. It's great material that we can use for other things if we can keep it out of the garbage stream. So we've rolled out this program here that you might find if you've got a single family home and we provide service to you. You can now put your organics into that container. It's limited still. We're driving up participation still, and we're going to be expanding it this year. But that's a core part of our strategy in the next couple of years, is really to drive the organics out. And there's a lot of exciting opportunities to do that. There's exciting opportunities for us in our own operations as well, just thinking about, again, how we pave our streets. Now 43% of the material for our construction projects is made from old construction sites. As we pull up a street, we grind it up and put it in the next new street. Save 10,000 dump trucks worth of material from entering the landfill, just on thinking about that one issue. So a lot of opportunity in our own operations. Access to nature. It is a wonderful city for nature, but there are gaps. There are things that additional things that we need to do. Opportunities, taking advantage of green roofs, taking advantage of abandoned streets or street ends, ways that we can integrate nature into other parts of our city, parts that may not have enough of it. So we're trying to convert street rights of ways into mini parks as an opportunity, and some of our city studio students are working on that. Who's working on that project? Okay, good. So that's an opportunity. We're looking for additional land where we can convert, create linear parks, and we're kind of a built-out city, so we need to be really creative in the ways that we engage and do more of this. For instance, greening Hastings Park, we're daylighting a creek there and doing more with the P&E is just one example. This is a way that we're engaging kids and our residents. We've got a Stanley Park Ecological Action Plan, engaging people, bringing them into the park and actually empowering them to play a role in that ecosystem. So there's ways that we can, through our programming, engage more people in the actual activity of maintaining those spaces. Lighter footprint is probably one of the greatest challenges for us. We have a very aggressive goal to achieve a one planet ecological footprint. How many of you know how many planets we use here in Vancouver? Amanda, okay, two? How many in the back?
Three.
Three? Amanda? 3.8? 3.6, someone said?
Four.
Four or five, yeah. It's about 3.5. planets to sustain the lifestyle of Vancouver, and we have the lowest greenhouse gas emissions of any city in North America, so clearly a long way to go. And many of these decisions are what you choose to eat, where that came from, what you consume, how big your house is, and a lot of things that we, the city, don't necessarily don't control and don't want to control. We want to give you tools to buy local food, though, and to choose more environmentally oriented lifestyle, so we can help by enabling in that area. We're doing a green neighborhood pilot. We're doing green city grants, getting our Greenest City data out there, trying to engage the communities in these kinds of activities because we know we can't do this one alone, and this is a serious challenge for us. C3 is our city studio. There you are, everyone in the back there, with the mayor. This is at one of our events. This is a city studio. We've heard about this. We've got a collaboration with our six post-secondary academic institutions working together in a city office to help solve some of the city problems in achieving this plan and identify opportunities. So they're looking at this semester, they're looking at full-time, this team developing solutions to build a green city and all sorts of exciting opportunities that they're developing. And so it's great to think about how do we engage academia in these challenges and opportunities. So starting to wrap up here, welcome Francis. Glad to have you here. Thank you for being here. Oh, good, good. We know that you catch it all. We read about it. So clean water, meet or beat the strongest BC Canadian international drinking water standards and reduce consumption. So we're looking at water quality and consumption. And people sometimes here say, well, why do we need to conserve? We've got so much of it. It comes down every day here. But the opportunity for us is by conserving, we can prevent the need to build reservoirs in future years. So there's a plan with the amount of growth that we have. If we continue the consumption levels that we're at, we'll need to build additional reservoirs, which are hundreds of millions of dollars. If we can conserve and bring on new development with lower levels of consumption, we may not need to build those reservoirs, which has an ecological function and an economic function. So again, looking at those opportunities. The second is really thinking about combined sewer overflows. Rainwater falls in the street here. Much of it ends up in the sewer system, which does back up and go into our waterways, and so we want to really address that. This is another leading by example story on water metering. We've rolled out this year a water metering program you may have heard about. It's been on the books for a very long time as a part of our plan. We got council to approve that. So we're thinking about how do we do that in a way that achieves our carbon goals as well. So we've converted to instead of driving around and going to each home, which created 864 driving days per year. We've gone to automatic meter reading. It's 36 driving days per year. That saves us money on staff time, saves carbon, wear and tear on the vehicles. So again, using these strategies to help achieve a carbon goal, environmental goal, but also save us some money as well, while providing a water conservation opportunity. So that's the kind of approach that we're looking at. And sewer separation is another strategy there. We've got a goal for 2050. What we've been doing is trying to be more strategic about the opportunities to create the sewer separation, so we're taking CSO offline and actually not pumping sewage into our waterways when we have a major storm event. So trying to be more strategic about where we have those opportunities to really close some of those CSOs. And we know we're having an impact, because False Creek, as we know, we had a whale in there a couple of years ago. So two more. Clean air. This is another one that's a bit of a challenge for us as a city. We don't control those levers. My member talked about where we have spheres of influence at the beginning of the presentation. This is one where we don't have as much influence. But we have partnerships. We're working closely with the port, looking at how they can take some of the work that they do and electrify that instead of using diesel. So there's a lot of opportunities that we have to have an influential role in this. EVs, as I mentioned. Electric vehicle infrastructure, we rolled out a significant, probably Canada's most aggressive electric vehicle charging program last week with our mayor. And so we're installing a whole series of EVs across our city and partnering very unique partnerships to get that done. So we know people are going to drive. We want to give them the opportunities to do that in an electric vehicle or an electric truck in Novec's case, or the Postal Service has now followed suit as well. So local food, closing on this, all of these things that I talked about, 1 through 9, many cases you're talking to the public, they kind of glaze over. But when you talk about food, people get engaged. And our food carts is a great example of that, ways that we can help to be a global leader in food and think about ways to get more local food served in our streets, in our schools, in our community centers, and in our homes. And so we're really excited about the opportunities here to double our food assets. And this is what we've kind of categorized as our food assets here in Vancouver. We've got some aggressive goals to increase farmers markets, and we recently changed the zoning code to allow that, and we've seen a significant increase as a result of that. But there's all sorts of other ways that we can support the local food economy. Supporting local agriculture in the city is a good example, where we've got a lot of land. The city has a bunch of land that we're planning to develop, or we're bringing together a bunch of parcels over a many-year period. We can consolidate those, and in the interim, before we develop them, we can grow food on them. As an example, Soul Food is a great opportunity for us. Last week, I think, or 2 weeks ago, council approved the city leasing to Soul Food for effectively $1 a year. 2 acres for them to do a pretty significant urban farm on. So again, create jobs, get more food in the local economy, use the resources that we have more effectively. And so that's the kind of approach that we're looking at on the local food front. What city assets do we have? Our procurement is an example that I've already mentioned, but also the land that we have. So there's a lot of work to do ahead. We know that the city is poised to lead. Mayor and council are committed. This is a wonderful vision. We need everybody to get there together. We can't do this alone. We know that. And so there's great opportunities for us to partner with our students, with our academic institutions, with our developers, with our business community. We often, and what we tried to kind of take into this plan as we were really building out the plan that council asked us to produce here is to think a little bit longer term. What can we do collaboratively as a city in the next 10 years? And think really aggressively and be serious about developing plans that will enable us to achieve these targets. And we think we have a good plan. It's a work in progress. You now have a copy of it in front of you, and I'm really happy to take any questions that you may have or comments about it. Thank you very much.
That had to be the fastest presentation of so much content.
Sorry.
I know, it was incredible. I want to make sure everybody, if you haven't got one of these, just put up your hand and we'll make sure that you get one. Okay, so we've got a few back there.
Did I stick
just
to
put
your...
up your hands and there we go, thanks.
Did I stick to your time limit?
You were fantastic. So what we want to do is, with any one of our Carbon Talks brown bag lunches, we want to ensure that you have a chance to ask questions. And so what we usually do is we group 3 questions, get us started, and then Sadhu will take the first 3 questions, then we'll go to the next 3 so we can hear from as many of you as possible. So let's see, who has questions now? I've got 1, Amy in the front. Anyone else? 2? And 3. So when you ask your questions, start by just introducing yourself, and you have to speak in the mic so that we can capture you on tape.
Hi, I'm Amy from the North Growth Foundation. I'm really interested in your zero waste policy that you were talking about. I know that density is going to be a key to the expansion of Vancouver. So with getting compost bins and trying to get compost out of the garbage, what are your plans for ramping that up? Because, I mean, I live in an apartment in the West End, and I'd love to be able to compost, but I don't have a backyard to do that in.
Okay, great. Thanks. Am I waiting? Is that the game plan? Okay.
Hi there. Hey. Andreas Ties. I'm with the Resource and Environmental Management Program at SFU. And my question is whether you've been looking at gray water recycling on a residential level and with, I guess, new buildings going up and big renos happening. And I guess it's happening in the commercial side, but on the residential side especially.
Okay, yeah. Great. Thanks.
Last one for this round.
God, rapid fire.
Yeah.
Can I make a comment first?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Can you introduce yourself?
Oh, yes, of course.
Oh, a comment.
No, it's good, actually.
Okay, good.
Charles Gossier with the Downtown Vancouver Business Improvement Association. You and I are having coffee later, Shauna. Okay. We haven't met yet. A comment is that I'm glad to hear that the city is saying we know people are going to drive, and we're going to accommodate it in a slightly different way. So my comment is that that's refreshing. Being in the job for almost 20 years, I've never heard that before. So I want to, you know, thank the city and yourself for acknowledging that and finding ways to accommodate and facilitate it. And the electric vehicles is a way to do that. So that's the comment. The question now gets to the question I have is this. My wife and I started composting during the last civic strike, and we've noticed that we're putting out less garbage in our tote to be picked up. Is the city moving towards a schedule other than every week for garbage pickup and recycling?
Great. Thanks. Those are your first three. And
okay, great. So two compost-related questions, really good questions. Thank you. Firstly, what we've seen is limited uptake on the program as it's been rolled out, and we did it. It was a quick start. We wanted to provide that service to homeowners. We have looked around the world, recognize that when you do switch the order, instead of picking up garbage every week and compost every other week, you're going to have limited uptake. When you flip the two around, you see the exact opposite. You see a lot more uptake. And so to your point, Charles, that is the direction that we think we need to go. We're doing a pilot on that right now in 2,000 households where we flip the garbage collection and the compost collection, and we've seen a dramatic increase in the participation, a dramatic increase. So we think that's the way to go, is just to switch that service. You get the same level of service, it's just reorganizing it. And so that's something we think we need to do based on the pilot and the success. We're actually developing a plan now to go forward to council with some recommendations on that. Regarding high-rises, council's also been pretty clear with us that we need to develop a solution for high-rises as well. We've, through our grants, I mentioned on the ecological footprint side, we've been piloting a number of strategies, one of which is with recycling alternatives, and they've developed in the West End a neighborhood compost collection program where you can actually take your material to them and they collect it and take it out for composting. So I think that's one potential solution, but there's a number of ways that we need to offer for a greater size buildings opportunities to compost, whether it's a centralized collection system or opportunities where people can take it outside of the building. They're now doing it at farm markets and other places as well. So it's going to be a multi-pronged approach. And we decided we need to lead by example, offer the service in our own collections, and then really engage the private sector and bring them along. And then gray water, absolutely. It's scale really helps with gray water. So we're looking at multiple buildings rather than just all in one building. You could do one cistern for three or four buildings to capture the storm water or to use the gray water. The Olympic Village is an example, and Roger can tell you all about that. But that's certainly a strategy that we would endorse, and would really look forward to seeing more single-family homes come forward with that solution as well. Yep, we're updating the building code this year. So one of the things we're working to do with the building code is to identify ways that we can incentivize people to build more green and looking at barriers that we may have in the building code that we need to address.
Great first three sets. So we have another question here, one at the back and one over here. So.
Thank you. Michael Alexander, an urbanist and the president of a 500-family strata in downtown, which this week began collecting food scraps and sending them off-site for composting.
Great.
We also have three restaurants and a very large supermarket in our strata, and none of them collect compost. So my question is, why isn't the city doing what San Francisco did 10 years ago, which is to grab the low-hanging fruit of collecting food scraps from large markets and restaurants?
Great. Thank you. Really good question.
Thanks, Michael. Here we go, racing up here. Maybe this isn't saving time, but here we go.
Hi, Sadhu, Wes Regan, Executive Director for Hastings Crossing Business Improvement Association. And I'll also add, I'm about to graduate from SFU's Faculty of Environment here too. So, my question actually kind of dovetails in the last one. I know there's a recommendation to extend the program into not just residential but also commercial properties for the food scraps diversion and composting. I'm just wondering how you envision that rolling out, where that compost will go. Is it going to go to Ladner or Langley, or can we have transfer stations, or can we have composting closer to the city? And a second question is, you mentioned that the city's looking at developing properties, but at the same time, we're looking at creative ways to use these areas for the GCAT goals. So in the long term, how can we keep these assets in place when considering things like the highest best use for different lands in the city? Do we need to look at rezoning some areas for light industrial? Can we add a new type of zoning? Like you mentioned, the green enterprise zone. How do you reconcile the fact that a lot of people are going to want to develop, let's say, condos, for example, or some other form of development? And how can these urban farms or composting sites or waste diversion sites, how can they compete in the long run with highest best use driven development policies?
So that's actually three questions there. Wes got in with the second one. So while you answer those, I'll head over to the other side.
Great. Good to see so many compost questions for our city studio folks. I hope you're... Do we have a compost team working on this issue? Oh, okay. We need more people. Okay. So... composting from businesses, really a very, very important point, and we've heard loud and clear from council as well on that. We are working as a region to build up the resources of where the material can go as well. We are kind of trying to grow the network for places that can process compost while we build up our own collection and lead the charge before we regulate. And we kind of collectively felt, before we go out and require the private sector to do something, we need to demonstrate that we are able to do it ourselves. So we are ramping up our program while we're putting the game plan for the commercial sector as well. So I really agree with you. We need to get them on board. We need to develop the various composting solutions as well. There's not too many places that you can do this in the Lower Mainland. There's actually a lack of capacity. So we are, to answer your question on where is the material going to go, all sorts of places, I presume. We don't want to see it put in trucks and driven miles and miles away, so we're looking for local solutions if we can, and we'll be doing an RFP for the next phase of our compost rollout to try to identify other locations and hopefully spur the market to establish more of these types of facilities. So it's a little bit of a chicken and egg kind of thing. We need the infrastructure to develop while the municipalities in the Lower Mainland are bringing more material online. So that's, and then your question on how do we protect these assets is a great question. I mean, you think about community gardens over the years in many, many cities. You see a community garden just happen organically, wonderful, brings the community together, and then the person who owns that property builds a house and kicks them off. And so there are different structures that you need to explore around protecting those types of assets, and I think it depends on what the asset is. Firstly, on the food piece, we have lots of assets that are around forever. I mean, thinking about our parks, how can we use those by planting blueberry bushes and fruit trees instead of just ornamentals? How can we bring the assets that we already have into productive use? And we've been doing that. We've planted a whole bunch of orchards in the last year in our parks and partnering with schools for the value added and the harvesting and community centers to actually use that material. So that's one, is thinking about what city assets do we already have that we can really unlock the power in those to leverage these programs. Second is looking at like Soul Food, those 2 acres. That is a transferable model. And that's something that we did in Chicago and many other cities. You partner with a nonprofit or somebody that wants to farm there, and they recognize they're going to pick up their beds, they're going to pick up their soil, and they're going to move if you need to redevelop that site in a few years. And it's a way for us to feel like we can use those sites for 3, 4, 5, 6, 10 years, but when they need to be redeveloped, that function goes to another site. And that actually works really well for some of these larger scale opportunities, and it's part of the design of how you implement that solution. And I think, to me, there's a mix where you got permanent assets and you've got ones that move based on the opportunities. And I think that's what's really neat about what Soul Food has done with their model. And then there are other areas like we're working on with Verticrop. You may have read in the paper a little while ago, where we actually have the top story of a parking garage that's totally, it's underutilized. Less people are driving downtown. Parking garages are not utilized as well. So we got a top floor of a city asset that we are leasing to an operation to do a vertical farm in. They're going to grow 190,000 pounds of produce on the top story of this garage using this very intensive system. So I think it's a series of strategies that we need to protect those types of assets.
Great. Are there a couple of other questions on this side, and then I'll come over to that side? Okay, here we go.
So this starts to sound like a compost question, but it's actually more than that. My name is Aliyah Lamadar. I'm with the Clean Tech Community Gateway, so we're helping communities to make better clean tech decisions. The drop spot pilot in the West End, I was talking with some friends recently, so they usually ask for a $2 donation every time we drop off a teeny little bio bag each week, and I would say that in a conversation I had with friends, 50% of them thought that was absurdly expensive, and 50% were like, no, for that kind of a service, I'd pay that. My question is, how do you convey to people the costs that are associated with these types of initiatives and what the benefits are? And also, is that $2 really the cost for me to drop off a bio bag? I'm just curious.
Come down here as well, sir.
Yeah, I just wanted to talk a little bit about the building code requirements. The BC Construction Association have just issued a study on the risks and litigation associated with third-party assessments, LEED programs. And I'm wondering whether, as you go forward into the building code revisions, whether you'll look at ASHRAE 89.1, which is the requirements for green buildings, which is codified rather than a third-party assessment, as a way of actually being more constructive around how the industry and the professionals move forward in green building design.
And your name is?
Roger Bailey.
Roger, thanks.
Thanks.
Hi, my name is Liz Blakeway. I'm a master's student here in the Urban Studies program, actually doing my research on the potential of on-site and neighborhood-scale composting.
All right.
But I'm not going to ask a composting question. I'm wondering, so you said that in the city's approach, you're looking at solving 3 to 4 problems in one green solution. So I'm wondering how you are thinking about engaging and enabling citizens of Vancouver to contribute to those achievements and those goals.
Great. So those are 3 great questions.
Great. I interpret the first and the last question to really be around engagement and the kind of a little bit of blending into behavior change. And I think it's those questions are Amanda and I are involved with a network of sustainability directors across North America, and those questions are the greatest challenge, I think, that cities are facing around these issues. Again, we can pave roads, we can build buildings, we can regulate. Those are things that we've done traditionally as a city for a very long time. So it's a little bit easier to address those. When it comes to behavior change and recognizing we need our businesses, we need our residents to participate and to understand these issues, It is probably the greatest struggle that these cities, from New York to Chicago and LA to Fayetteville and Atlanta, and Portland and Calgary and Edmonton. We all talk about this. We actually have a working group of city representatives that are struggling with this because there aren't that many levers that we have. And so fee baits or thinking about how things are priced or how we provide service is one way to do that. But it is a challenge. It is a significant challenge for us, and one that we are certainly tackling here with the compost rollout is a great example. How do you communicate to people the value of them taking the time to divert that material and why they should bother collecting it in their kitchen and dealing with the odors and the fruit flies and the other challenges? I mean, they've got to change their lives in order for us to achieve these goals. So I don't really have an answer for you. I think it's certainly more of a focus on community-based social marketing, certainly more opportunities to engage with people online, answer questions, and address some of the kind of cost-benefit questions that they may ask. But I guess I would say I don't have an answer to that, and it is a challenge that cities are struggling with. And the traditional model of put an ad in the paper or put up an ad, we're competing with Coca-Cola and major corporations that have millions of dollars to spend, and so I think we need to be more creative and engage all parts of our community through volunteerism and through our schools to get the message out in ways that are a little bit different, because competing for ad buys is virtually impossible, I think. So
is that $2 just an arbitrary number?
Oh, you know what? That's, I don't know.
Okay.
That's a nonprofit organization. That's a separate organization that provides that service. I don't know how they came up with that. Sorry, can't help you on that one. And then on the building codes piece, that's a really good suggestion. Thanks, Roger. And I know we're looking into ASHRAE, and I will circle back on that one. Do you know the answer to that?
Okay. We got three, no. One, two, and three.
So. Good afternoon. My name is Leanne Leek. I'm a student with City Studio, also studying environmental sociology at SFU. My question is about recycling. I live in the West End. I've been there for about 12 years. And I did my own little research project about recycling programs and looked at Edmonton, Toronto, and Vancouver, and realized that Vancouver seemed a little bit behind in what they're recycling with regards to plastics. And still we're recycling the same plastics since the beginning of the program in the 1980s. So my question is that changing, and what the plan and the time frame is for that change?
Thanks very much.
Hey. Hello, my name is Scott Graham. I have a solar energy company, and I don't know if I can frame this in a question, but my experience seems to be a little different than yours, I think. I find it extremely tough to get any traction in the city. What solar is done, it's done probably at 2 to 4 times the capital cost, and it's proven to be uneconomical. And there is stuff that is, but it just in getting it in the city is too difficult. And also the gas company is the arbitrator of what types of projects that we do, which seems a little odd to me as well. So I don't know where the question is in there, but it's certainly a comment on I have a tough time in the city of Vancouver doing renewable energy.
Solar or PV?
Solar thermal.
Oh. Gord Price, City Program. Really, a request for you to be reflective. Your experience now is almost generational. You're almost a pioneer in sustainability going back to Chicago. How do you personally deal with denialism, particularly around climate change, from the highest leadership in this country down to, I'm sure, discussions that you've had at a personal level? How have you seen it change? What approaches have worked? And where do you think it's going to go?
What nihilism? Next question.
We have a questions coming in on Twitter too, which we'll come to as well.
Does that answer your question, or no? I was actually recently asked to speak at a conference in New York, a small gathering of folks working on behavior change, particularly as it relates to climate change, and understanding what messages resonate with people, and from a personal perspective, it's very encouraging to be here in Vancouver because there's a lot of understanding among our business community, among our residents of why we're doing this. We've got a mayor and council that are really committed. So you asked personally and to be reflective. I'm really energized being here and seeing the level of interest and commitment to this issue here. With that said, it's frustrating to see national governments doing the games that they're doing and see cities really charging forward, leading with so few resources actually to support it. So that is frustrating. But overall, personally, I just feel energized by the changes that we are able to make, and really feel enthusiastic about the opportunities before us. They're not all easy. We're kind of just scratching the surface, but I think there's I feel like we're collectively going to step up, and I'm. You want to elaborate on that? It is a very interesting question, so I'm happy to. No.
Well, I'm going to.
She's the leader. Okay.
We're just going to keep going because I know there's a number of
Scott,
other people with questions.
You're on solar. I hope I didn't give you the impression from my presentation that this is easy or we figured it all out. New technologies with existing building codes and staff that are figuring it out and working through it. There definitely are issues, and I've dealt with a number of them, in particular solar installations in Vancouver where there were challenges. If you have specific examples, I'm happy to sit down with you and look at specific examples that you're dealing with and bring in our building staff and work with you on it. So happy to talk offline because we're trying to move forward and change doesn't happen overnight, so there are challenges. So
it's
thank you for that.
It's not the problem, which you and I have actually somewhat dealt with. It's the opportunities that we're missing.
Okay.
Just to let you know.
Okay, so good. We solved the problem when we met a year ago, and now we got missed opportunities. I agree with you. So I'm happy to hear more and talk more about that. And then Leanne, on recycling, what we're recycling, what's our plan and our timeline. We are in a little bit of a holding pattern. There is extended producer responsibility that has been mandated. So the industry is required to establish a plan for all paper and packaging waste. And industry is now going to be required to develop systems to collect that, from a Starbucks coffee cup to the wrapper, plastic bags, to pretty much everything, all the packaging that we consume, which is a large portion of what's in the recycling bin and what's in the garbage bin. And so the industry is putting together a plan now to do that. We're not sure yet as a municipality how that's going to impact us. And so many additional types of plastic are included in that. And so we're waiting to kind of see where that lands. We're working with them to try to get it to a point so that we feel comfortable with it and that it will provide improved service for our residents. But that's a little bit of why you're not seeing any changes out of us yet. That plan is supposed to be implemented within the next couple of years. So, and they're coming out with their draft plans this spring and their final plans this fall. So it's very, very interesting. BC is one of the first in North America to do this. So you might even see an actual systematic change across the Lower Mainland. So whether you're in Burnaby or Surrey or Vancouver, you'd have the same types of materials that were accepted in the same way. So it could actually really provide some great value to residents in Lower Mainland.
So this will be the last round. We have one, two, and one more person. There we go.
Hi, my name is Elodie. I'm working with Carbon Talks. I just have two questions here on Twitter for you. One from SDMGZ, who is asking, to make buildings carbon neutral, most of it will have to be done by retrofitting existing ones. Who will pay and how? And the second question is from Offsetters, asking for you to speak about the Talk Green to Us program and about any learnings from that would shape future campaigns.
Great. Marion, thanks.
Marion Town from the Fraser Basin Council. Because you're not doing enough. Good to see you, Sadhu.
Yes,
the question is really thinking, I think the city is clearly being incredibly innovative and is advancing leadership on many different fronts. And I was really glad to hear you speak about the other major cities in North America with whom you're working and sharing and collaborating. I also think within our own region and within the bigger, kind of larger region, there are many municipalities teetering on the brink of decisions that will push them into becoming greener or not. And I wonder, we have a structure called Metro Vancouver that sometimes, that certainly brings 21 municipalities together. I'm just wondering if there's a different way to engage with at a staff level to advance more sharing, so there's less of this continuous recreating of the wheel, and how you might be able to advance that, perhaps through a structure like Metro.
Thanks, and Janet.
Hi, Janet Moore from SFU Center for Dialogue and City Studio. And this actually builds right on Marion's question, which comes from a reflection on a field trip we went on this morning to Van Dusen, to the new living building there. And maybe it's for you to comment on an opportunity or a gap, which is they have this incredible structure and place and green building,
But there was clearly a gap in terms of operations and capacity for their staff to even know where to start or have funding to have someone in the building that actually could implement those systems. And I think, they don't even have capacity to have even the conversation about how do we get someone in here to be having a conversation with CSRS or what's happening at SFU or UBC or all these organizations. And it seems to me there's a green economic opportunity for human resources to not just be thinking about infrastructure, but people that can have these conversations and move between these centers of excellence, because it was sad to see they're not even composting in this building.
You had to get composting in there, huh? Very smooth. Okay, on the Twitter questions, the first one, retrofitting, who will pay? The way that we're doing it now is, I'm looking at you because you asked, but to the Twittersphere. Hey, I just coined that. That's probably not. I can't imagine someone like me would coin something new in the Twittersphere. this is the kind of thing we're looking to use all the tools that we have, from fee baits to incentives like we've developed. But ultimately, if you own a building, it's your responsibility to put a new roof on it or to upgrade it. And we expect that the building owner would be responsible for making those upgrades. From offsetters, our learnings from Talk Green to Us, we've actually learned a lot from that engagement. 36,000 people is one of probably the largest engagements we've had as a city. So we've engaged many of our Vancouver residents in the methods that we learned from that, in Talk Housing with us, in Talk Transportation with us. So we've actually taken some of the lessons and have been using them since then, and really on a ramped up engagement program that council's directed us to do. So I think the key lessons for that is go to other people where they are rather than trying to bring people to you, because there's great audiences across the city and we should go to them with our message rather than trying to get them to us. Do an engagement online, but make sure if someone posts a question or asks for something or gives you an idea that you respond to them. Like, we integrated this into the plan and here's why, or we didn't. So if it's happening online, it's not just enough to be receiving. We need to be taking feedback back to people that are participating online. And balance online versus in person. It's not enough just to do online. You need to be engaging with people, and we did all sorts of things. We developed DIY kits for people in their homes so they could have a coffee party or a potluck with their neighbors and talk about these things. So we need to provide different ways for people to engage, I think, would be some of the key learnings from that. Working regionally, Marion, I think we do have a really good platform with Metro, and Metro's done an amazing job with what they've done in terms of they've got a food strategy, they've got a growth strategy, and the municipalities are engaged in that. But I do agree, I think there's an opportunity to ramp up and have more engagement cross-municipality, because you can't... District energy is a great example. Like, you may have a heat source in one community and a need in another, and we need to figure out how these communities can work together to address those types of challenges, and I don't think we're equipped yet to do that. So we are better off than most regions, I think, because we do have Metro and the municipalities work well together, and it's a good, well-run organization. I think we've got opportunities to go even further with that and engage for real municipal partnership. And then, Janet, to your question, I couldn't agree more, and that's the point I was trying to make. We're good with infrastructure. We've had a lot of experience with that as cities, but it's not enough to build a green building and then let it go. And it's the same challenge in Chicago and cities across. I had LEED certified schools with no recycling in them. Some of the first LEED silver schools that we did in North America were in Chicago, and the students were going about their business as if nothing was different in this school. We had a wonderful green roof, but no one was ever going up onto it. They'd never figured out how to program it. And so getting from the infrastructure piece to the real deep engagement piece is a challenge. And I think they say straight up that is a challenge cities across North America are facing, and that's where the partnerships come in, like C3, the City Studio, and other ways that we can engage with the partnerships that we have across the city to activate it. I'm not sure a city staff person being a greeter there is the right model. There may be a partnership with the Canadian Green Building Council or other ways to activate those buildings. We've got an audio tour that you can go to different places. So finding ways that are creative that don't involve us necessarily kind of using the model that we have now, it's thinking creatively in this. I think a lot of opportunities, but real challenges to do that. Okay, I think I've run through all of our questions.
16 questions in 30 minutes, 10 goals in 25 minutes. You are a wonder.
Are you done
First, I want to thank you very, very much. This has been a delight having you here. I want to thank each of you. We always say you could be somewhere else, but you made the commitment to be here, and that says a lot. So I want to thank each of you. Thank you for creating a dialogue process for us here. And this is really something that we do monthly, and we want to invite you to be a part of that. So if you've left us your information, we'll make sure that you know when our next Carbon Talks is. Again, I want to ensure that everybody has a chance to pick up one of the Greenest City Action Plans. There might even be a couple of extras if you want to take them back to your offices and share them. And I want to thank the City of Vancouver, Amanda Petrie-Hayes, and particularly Sadhu Jonhston, the North Growth Foundation, PICS, and the SFU Center for Dialogue. Thanks again.